We want to take it straight to Kisumu County. Joining us now is my colleague Wycliffe Okechi. He's on standby just to talk to religious leaders from the region on what they have to say concerning this particular subject, the role of the church in politics. It's over to you, Wycliffe.
Well, a very good morning to you, Safina Chengo back in Nairobi. We're coming to you live from the lakeside city of Kisumu here. And what a wonderful conversation you are having there right in the studio. And at this point, Safina, you'll allow me to chip in with the perspective from Kisumu, and I'll engage two gentlemen here who are actually opinion shapers in this region of Kisumu. And just straight away, Mr. Gabriel. There seems to be an increased dalliance between the political class and the church. What do you make of this new emerging trend?
Thank you so much. As you've heard, my name is Edgu Chingodoyo, a political leader and opinion shaper in Kisumu. Basically, the dialogue, we call it the dialogue between the political leadership and the church now, is growing so much. And that, you believe, politicians survive on numbers. And because of the pandemic, which is COVID-19, holding a political rally is a problem. So they take to the church. You realize the people have also, we've cultured a nation whereby we listen so much to what politicians say, even more than what even our spiritual leaders say. So the politicians go to church in pretense that because of their position and our culture in the nation, you respect your leader. Because of that, they go to the church and then they will be given a chance and then they take the politics to the church. Basically, in the thought that us as a people will benefit, but basically it is the politicians who are benefiting. But they're telling you, believe you me, that once a politician gets to the church and a sermon has been given, because they speak after the sermon, once a sermon has been given and a politician speaks later, you ask any member of the church what was preached, they will not tell you, but they will remember exactly what the politician said. So basically, we are interfering with the spiritual nourishment of our people with politics.
Just on that note, do you think that this should be bad or should be relegated in any way?
It should be relegated. And then I think the church leadership and our national church leadership should reduce this to, let's finish issues of the church within the church, do the prayers and finish the prayers. If the politicians want to speak, let them speak out of the church so that now they can deal with the administration. So if there's a crowd, then they should not ask the church, they'll ask the politician.
And in the end of it all, what's the end game? Does this stand to benefit the politicians in any way in the fullness of time?
Politicians always have a people's court, and the people's court is the numbers. So every time a politician would want to speak, and they want to speak to multitudes, and that's why they go to church, they go to them to funerals and all that. And if you realize, the culturing of our people is what is bad. People will go to a funeral and they will leave early if there's no politician. But if there's a politician, they will sit and wait. And when the politician speaks, it is fire. Even in the church, you can see this concentration of the congregation when a politician is speaking is different from the concentration of the preacher. So the politicians are really benefiting, but the people are not.
So that means the congregation is the contributing factor to this emerging trend?
Yes, because we've given them a listening ear. We've agreed to listen to them. If we refuse to listen to them, politicians will never go where they're not wanted. If you can see, for example, now we are talking about climbing Mount Kenya and all that. You realize that people were not getting there because, you know, if you go, you'll not get the cheer that you want. You'll get a booing. So a politician will not go where they're going to be booed. They want to go to where they are going to be cheered. So the church is a soft spot for them. You go to church, people are humble. Even rogues go to church, and when they are there, they are very humble. So the politicians benefit because they will get even the rogue, even the person who doesn't want, they will listen to them. You cannot make nice in church.
Thank you so much, Mr. Edgar. Safina, you'll allow me again to engage one more gentleman here by the name of Gabriel. Gabriel, according to you, what do you make of this new emerging trend? Why are politicians increasingly becoming actually building that dalliance with the church?
Thank you very much, Wycliffe, for giving me this airtime. I'm Gabriel Ochieng. I'm the former MCA Kondele Ward and also pioneer MCA Kisumu County Assembly. Wycliffe, I want to say and state it categorically that there is a thin line between church and politics. And you can remember that the church has really played a big role. It's been a game changer in our politics way back from 1982 to 1996 when it was so active. Then it came a bit cool after then. But I want to say that the politicians have gotten this chance now, because you know, recently when the president met his brothers, the Okoa team and the political bigwig Raila Amolo Odinga, they say that the COVID variant that is there now, we should disengage from gathering. And then after that one was disbanded, then what next? The church became the place where the politicians could go and air their views.
And just on that note, why, in your opinion, should this be curtailed or regulated to some sort? And if yes, how?
Precisely, it should be curtailed. I think the church should be left for spiritual nourishment. If the church has any other function that they want to call the politician, let it be done on a day not of the day of worship, so that they can distinguish between what time to play politics and what time to engage spiritually. So, and I want to say that the church also, if they take, they be partisan in any time of politics, then our country is not going to go well. Because when they say they support this and they support this person, then they'll start having headways and nothing is going to go out. So I'm praying, because it is their duty. If you see the Beatitudes of Jesus in Matthew chapter 5 from 1 to 12, this number 7, verse 7 says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they be called the children of God. Who are the peacemakers? They'll be the church. They are the ones who are going to be called the peacemakers. But what about the politicians? They'll continue with their politics. And there's nothing that is going to hinder them from doing politics. So politics and church is one.
And where do you think the buck stops? Is it with the leadership of the church, or the politicians should actually, in their own way, should desist from using the pulpit to maybe to steer their political agenda?
It is both the church and the politicians. Because if the church say we don't want politics in our church, we don't want to welcome any politician, then the politicians will find their way. But if they allow them to come, they'll continue visiting churches in the name of going to worship, but it will be politics.
Thank you, Mr. Gabriel, for that insightful perspective. Safin, actually, you've got it right from two gentlemen here who are actually very opinion shapers in this region of Kisumu. And you, just like you heard from them, they're saying like the increased dialogue between the political and political class and the church is due to the ban on political gatherings, actually. And you do realize that politicians thrive in gatherings, and just because the political gatherings have been banned, and now it's the church that have become a soft spot for politicians, which according to these two gentlemen stands that kind of new trend stands to benefit the politicians in the fullness of time. But if this will be regulated or curtailed in any way, that is a matter of wait and see. For now, that is it from my end here in Kisumu. Safin, allow me to hand it back to you in studio so that you can continue with that interview, with that discussion. Safin, back to you.
So much, and I pick it from you, Wycliffe. Thank you for that, coming to us live from Kisumu County, talking to those two gentlemen who've shared quite useful insights.